One thing about the Fermi paradox is that the potential solutions to it keep growing in number. Some are more prominent than others, such as the zoo hypothesis, or that there simply aren't any alien civilizations nearby to detect. But all we really have about the solutions to the Fermi paradox are ideas. And there are also obscure solutions that, while they are at least plausible, they are not well fleshed out or talked about when discussing the subject. So here are 10 obscure solutions to the Fermi paradox. Number 10. Aliens don't like planets. The biggest problem with solving the Fermi paradox is that, given that we've never seen an advanced alien civilization, and we ourselves aren't yet advanced enough to colonize other star systems, then how exactly can we predict just where aliens would choose to be? We assume, such as in SETI searches, that civilizations would be interested in wet planets that orbit ancient, quiescent sun-like stars, or smaller stars like red dwarfs, and as a result, that's where we point our radio telescopes. And we also think in terms of energy production being a key factor, that aliens might construct Dyson swarms around their home star to collect energy, and indeed, Kardashev's scale is based on energy use. If that's the case, however, then there are far more powerful stars in this galaxy to harness energy from than sun-like stars. But these stars tend to be hostile environments where life is not expected to arise. Certain types of giant stars would provide many, many times the energy output of the sun. The problem is that these stars are short-lived and die violently by supernova, but there is a period where they might be useful as energy sources. One scenario would be where an alien civilization heads out into the universe, abandoning their home star system, and setting up shop for a few million years at one of these giant stars, and then they simply move on before it goes supernova, heading for the next suitable star. Finding evidence of such a civilization would be a needle in a haystack, and could literally be anywhere in the galaxy if they're in the process of traveling, or they're camped out next to a star that would otherwise not be considered a likely target by SETI. Number 9. Surface oceans might be rare. One of Earth's great mysteries is just how it acquired its water. This is still hotly debated, but one strong possibility is that sometime around 3.85 billion years ago, Earth was bombarded by icy comets originating from the Oort cloud. It's certainly an interesting notion that every time you take a drink of water, you may be consuming something that came from the Oort cloud. But there's a bigger mystery here. What caused the disturbance in the Oort cloud that sent all those comets our way? The answer is, we don't know and we may never. If comets are indeed the source for Earth's water, then whatever event disturbed them might have been a rare event, such as a closely passing star. If this is the case, it may be that rocky planets within the habitable zones of their stars that have oceans may be the exception rather than the rule in the universe. If so, then life itself might be rare on habitable zone terrestrial worlds. While there are other hypothetical solvents that extraterrestrial life might be based on, water is very common in the universe, and one of the more likely things we can say about alien biological life is that it's very likely to be based on carbon and water rather than any other combination, just because both are widely available in the galaxy. It's worth noting here that this only applies to oceans on terrestrial planets. If our solar system is any indicator, subsurface oceans are probably very common in the universe. We have numerous moons in our solar system, and even an asteroid, that seem to sport liquid water below their surfaces. It's possible that those places, too, might be abodes of life. But there are problems here. One is that Earth's water contains about half as much heavy water as some comets do, suggesting that our water actually came from the asteroids and planetesimals that Earth formed from, which generally have the same ratio of heavy water as Earth. However, measurements of more recent comets showed some of them to have the same ratio as Earth, muddying the story, though those comets are known to have originated in the Kuiper Belt, so it may be that our water originated there rather than the Oort cloud. The other problem is that geology is showing us that minerals that form in the presence of water show that water was here very early, bolstering the case for it originating with asteroids and planetesimals, in which case there would be no reason to think that ocean worlds like Earth would be rare in the universe. Number 8. Aliens have different or no math. One open question within astrobiology is the question of mathematics. Is our ability to perform complex mathematical calculations a result of our evolution, or is it present in all life that gets to this stage of evolutionary development? We don't know, but we do get hints that some animals do have a limited ability to comprehend numbers, but it's different to what we would normally think of as counting. It's thought that animals might do this through subitizing. Think of it like this: if you have four cookies on a plate, You don't need to count them. Rather, you seem to instinctively know that there are four because there are only so many ways to arrange four objects. This becomes more complicated with numbers much larger than that. But another way animals might subitize is a cat preferring a larger bowl of food just because it looks bigger. It doesn't need to count pieces of food to know that one bowl has a larger quantity. But there are cases of people with neurological conditions dealing with perception that can subitize but are unable to count objects in a room, suggesting that subitizing and counting originate in different areas of the brain. This may suggest that humans' mathematical abilities are hardwired into our brains through evolution, but this may not be so for an otherwise intelligent alien species. If the conditions in which they evolved were different from the conditions that predisposed us to mathematics, then they may have no conception of it. If, for example, they didn't need the ability to understand larger numbers of prey or predators as we seemingly did, they might not get math. It's hard to imagine such a mathless civilization getting very far. Building rockets would be beyond unlikely without mathematics, but that doesn't preclude such a civilization from existing. If not being able to use math or having a very different concept of what math is and how to do it is the norm for the universe, then civilizations of otherwise intelligent aliens could exist but never venture into space, or try to contact anyone with radio transmitters because they simply can't build them. Number 7. The chemistry is too hard to happen often. Tracing the chemistry of the origins of life has been difficult, and scientists still don't have a complete picture of what actually happened when life got its start on Earth. We have hints. The Miller-Urey experiments first showed that the building blocks of life could be created relatively straightforwardly in an environment like early Earth. RNA and DNA, however, have not been so forthcoming. And, for the time being, we do not see simple life emerging from successor experiments to the Miller-Urey work, just the building blocks for life. But this is something that we are moving towards. In the coming decades, scientists will likely unravel the chemistry of abiogenesis and will finally have an answer. This answer could solve the Fermi paradox in one shot. If it turns out that the chemistry is relatively straightforward, or even inevitable under the right conditions, then the universe probably teems with simple life and maybe more. But if it turns out to be hard, essentially a fluke, that can only happen under really strict conditions, then we have our solution to the Fermi paradox. We may not be alone, and there could be other life or even civilizations out there, but they may be very, very rare, to the point that they can never interact with each other. Working against this, of course, is that we're clearly here. We show that life is possible, and this planet is full of life, but it's all related, and life only seems to have developed here once. There could be many reasons for that. Maybe it did happen multiple times, and it's just that they didn't survive or were consumed by existing life. And there's another take on this. You would think that nuclear fission wouldn't be very likely to happen in nature. It seemed for years to be a thing you'd only expect to find in a reactor or a bomb. But evidence of natural nuclear fission in uranium deposits has been found. It's not common, but it happens. Perhaps the chemistry of abiogenesis works along those lines. It happens occasionally in the universe, but it's merely uncommon. Number 6. The scientifically frustrated universe. We live in a time where we're about to be presented with an increasing amount of ethical questions about how to manage our own future. Transhumanism, for example, or the ideas of the technological singularity, tell us that we are getting so advanced that our own future may be incomprehensible to most of us. We may reach a point, perhaps sooner rather than later, that brings us to a level of technological development where we are quite simply no longer human. Ideas of uploading oneself into a computer, or customizing the body genetically, or living many times longer than a current human through augmentation come up. Do we necessarily want these developments? Will there come a time where we simply say no, we don't want to change on that level and we simply choose to remain human? Or perhaps more likely, a majority choose to remain human, but some choose augmentation. Could this happen with colonization of the galaxy, where we simply conclude that there's no need to do it, it's better to spend our time bettering Earth while still remaining human? Might others conclude this as well? A variant of this idea is that we simply might run out of science, and that certain questions within science are simply unanswerable with any reasonable study. Take, for example, the standard model of cosmology. It's a model that seems to explain observations well enough, but it's not a complete model. We still have questions about things like dark energy and dark matter. And the best theory we have, general relativity, breaks down at quantum scales. So, we have theories that predict what we see, but we don't actually know how they work. What if we never do? What if no one ever does? This could happen. The experiments needed to prove certain concepts, such as string theory, or determining if backwards time travel is possible, may be so impractical that they cannot be attempted in our universe. There may simply be too much energy involved, or too much distance in order to do the experiments. In other words, a scientific brick wall may await us and everyone else in the Milky Way at some point, and colonization just is never in the cards. My guess is that would be one frustrating universe where everyone hits the scientific and technological brick wall and just can't get any further. This is a particularly interesting solution because it seems like our own development over the next 5 decades will answer whether it is viable, or maybe it won't. But we have radio, so perhaps the first message we might receive from an alien civilization, even one millions of years older than ourselves, might be a query to see if we figured out our way past certain scientific mysteries. Number 5. You need more than one habitable planet for life. One of the greatest mysteries within the story of the origins of life on Earth is if it originally is from here at all. There are certain signs that it might not be, such as it having appeared on Earth virtually the first moment it could. That could simply be how it happened, or it only appears that way because early Earth was contaminated with life from somewhere else. The conspicuous candidate for this is Mars, which is much smaller and its surface would have cooled faster and presumably would have been habitable earlier than Earth. While it's unknown what the conditions were for the genesis of life, and indeed we're not sure which came first, DNA or RNA, but if it were RNA, there may be a hint that life actually originated on Mars. Some researchers believe that there was a chemical catalyst involved in the formation of RNA, a kind of scaffold. The best chemical candidates for this do not seem to fit Earth well. For example, you'd need oxidation at a time when Earth's atmosphere had very little oxygen, and you'd also need a relatively dry environment, which Earth was not. Mars, however, may have better fit the bill, but it no longer does, and Earth is now the better world, dramatically altered by its life that it is. So the question is, do you need two planets exchanging material for life that leads to a civilization to get going? This might make intelligent life in the universe rare, but it's worth noting that we now know of star systems like TRAPPIST-1 that have multiple planets within the habitable zone of the star that could all be transferring material between themselves. Number 4. Intelligence is a fluke. Right now, there are an estimated 8 to 14 million species living on planet Earth. Across the age of life on Earth, that number is far higher. It's thought that as much as 99% of all species to have existed on Earth are now extinct. Out of all of those species, only one can build and launch a rocket. Even the other extinct members of our genus, the Neanderthals, Homo erectus, and so on, did not develop sufficient or the right kind of intelligence to head to the moon. Going on that premise that so far we are the only spacefaring radio telescope building species ever to appear in this world, and then only recently after billions of years of life on Earth, that wouldn't seem to bode well for intelligence appearing commonly on exoplanets. Could it be that the conditions that caused us to develop our intelligence were so unlikely that human intelligence is actually a fluke? We don't know, but if we continue to see no indicators of intelligent alien life in the galaxy, at some point we will have to consider this option. Number 3. The scientifically happy universe. One thing is clear, we do not have a complete view of most areas of science. We know some, but not all. One area where this is somewhat pronounced is physics. We don't have a complete view of it, especially when trying to reconcile the aforementioned general relativity with quantum theory. One area that may link the two might be string theory, but that's still unclear. It may not be, and within that missing puzzle piece might lay some interesting things about the universe. This might include things like parallel universes existing, or even other areas of science that we're not yet aware of. So that creates a question. Would a civilization that has a very good handle on astrophysics still bother to study it much? Perhaps science leads in a direction that once you know how stars work and galaxies merge and so on, then there comes a time where your understanding is so complete that you simply focus on other areas where your understanding is still incomplete, such as things like string theory, which appear very hard to test. Why study this universe when you can study a more interesting alternate one that you have little understanding of? Or they may come across something within science that makes the whole study of it frivolous past the development of technology. One option here is if it were discovered that the universe is unequivocally a simulation. Is nature all that interesting when you know it's all fake? Number 2. Not enough mass extinctions. We tend to think of mass extinctions as terrible calamities, and they are. But think for a moment about what happened in the aftermath of the Cretaceous-Tertiary mass extinction. By removing the dinosaurs, birds excepted, it allowed for the rise of the mammals. That in turn resulted in us. Had that asteroid not struck 66 million years ago, we very likely wouldn't be here, and this planet may well still be dominated by giant reptiles. It could be said that our evolution is a direct result of that mass extinction. Whether the dinosaurs would have eventually developed intelligence and civilization is completely speculative. Maybe, maybe not. Though one does have to wonder what happens to rocketry and space exploration when your astronaut is 70 feet long and weighs 25 tons. That aside, it may be that early Earth's relatively frequent, but not too frequent, mass extinction events helped the process of evolution to eventually produce us. And there is some evidence of this. During periods where there is little pressure on species, evolution tends to slow down. Under periods where the situation changes, such as the aftermath of an asteroid impact, it appears to speed up. If mass extinctions on an exoplanet with life happen too slowly, then it may take significantly longer to reach a situation where intelligence can evolve. If the cadence is too rapid, it might completely reset the conditions of the planet before it gets too far along any given path. Number 1. It's very slow out there. One assumption we tend to make when searching for exocivilizations is that we all perceive time the same way. This may not be the case. An example of how this might work comes not from science fiction for a change, but fantasy. The Ents from The Lord of the Rings communicated and presumably thought dramatically slower than hobbits, leading to frustration on the hobbits' part. But it wasn't that the Ents were less intelligent, it was that they operated fundamentally on a slower basis. There's no reason that this might not be the case for an alien civilization. This might lead to very long, slow communications times. Take the infamous WOW signal, which, contrary to popular belief, remains unexplained and did not turn out to be due to comets. It was a single narrowband burst of radio at 1420 MHz. It looked like a signal generated by technology, but it has not been detected since. But if transmissions only repeat every 50 years, just to put a random, arbitrary number on it, then it's no wonder that we haven't seen it again. But we would pick it up again in 2027. That might mean that 50-year intervals aren't very long periods of time for a slow civilization, and it may not just be a biological phenomenon. Technology could play a role here. If that civilization were near enough to a black hole, they would be affected by time dilation, or they may choose to slow down their perception of time technologically for some purpose. And the opposite could also be true. They might be sped up compared to us, in which case their transmissions might only run for a blink of an eye, making it very unlikely that we'll just happen to be looking at the right part of the sky at the right time to catch them. Thanks for listening. I am futurist and science fiction author John Michael Godier, and be sure to check out my books at your favorite online book retailer and subscribe to my channels for regular in-depth explorations into the interesting, weird, and unknown aspects of this amazing universe in which we live.